नमस्ते डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू दिस ऑनलाइन लेक्चर सीरीज बाय द डॉक्टर बाबा साहेब आंबेडकर ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी। आई डॉक्टर हिमांशु पटेल वेलकम यू फॉर द सब्जेक्ट ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम ऑफ बीसीए प्रोग्राम। सो इन टूडेज सेशन वी विल गेट इंट्रोडक्शन टू ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम। सो लेट अस स्टार्ट। In today's session, we will learn about few things. We will get introduction of operating system. Then we define what is operating system is. Then we discuss why we need operating system and what are the objectives of operating system. And finally, we will learn how modern operating system is evaluated from the beginning. So let us start with introduction part. Students, in the last two decades, the power of computing has changed. Nowadays, computers are becoming more powerful. The storage capacity and computing speed are extremely fast. In earlier days, you might know that our primary memory is of megabyte size and our hard disk is of gigabyte size. But nowadays, your main memory or primary memory is of gigabytes and your hard disk is up to terabyte also. And now we have small solid state drive also, which is very fast compared to our traditional hard disk. So we can say the storage capacity and computing speed are extremely fast nowadays. Today's computer application are becoming user friendly with fast processing capability. In this information age, everyone is concerned with the computer and its performance. Everybody require lots and lots of information from computer. So processing information is major task. Nowadays, computer with good speed is a basic necessity. Earlier, if people want to buy a computer, it is considered as a luxury. But now, computer becomes our necessity, not a luxury. It is a use for day-to-day requirement. So people do majority of their work with the help of computer. They use computer for the online shopping, booking railway and air ticket, account management, storing file and many more. Even you are watching this live video session with the help of either your mobile or laptop or computer. So people use computer in their day-to-day life. Now you might have some question, or you should have some question like, have you ever thought how all these works are done? How does the computer manage all the work given by the user without any error? How does the computer manage all the attached device or hardware with the help of user? So answer to all these question is operating system. We are using computer, and for computer to perform efficiently and in user-friendly manner, we require operating system, right? In the beginning of computer era, the task to be performed by user were directly given to hardware. There is a close interaction between human and computer hardware. For example, I want to write a program. Even I have to think on which computer I am going to execute my program. So these made the user of computer difficult, as user had to know the architecture of computer system. Now you might have another question, what is computer architecture? So you might heard that this system has a Intel processor. This system has a AMD Athlon processor. This system is 32-bit system. This system is 64-bit system. So basically every processor has a unique set of instruction for its execution. So in earlier days, you have to think what are the instruction which is specific to particular processor, and then you can write your program. Now later on, what will happen? Softwares were designed to assist user, to help the users. There is a one layer between hardware and user were introduced, and that layer is a called operating system. The objective of this software is to minimize the interaction of user with hardware and allowing user to perform all functionality easily. That means you need not to think about what kind of hardware you are using. You have to just use it. You have to concentrate on using hardware and not on using on how it works and so on. An operating system is the first program that is loaded into computer by boot program. It manages all the applications run on the computer. When you buy any system or laptop, the prerequisite is that before running any other program, your system should have an operating system. All other program depends on the facility provided by operating system. So using this boot program, the first computer starts operating system, and then you can use any other program. If you buy computer system without any operating system, before running any program, you must install your operating system. That is why we can say, for example, Microsoft Word program is designed for Windows operating system. It cannot run on another operating system. So every program relies on the facility provided by operating system. It cannot work without any operating system. So an operating system acts as a layer between user or application and the hardware. It works in background. You might wonder that my programs are running very well, but ultimately every program depends on the facility provided by operating system. So operating system works in background without letting us know who is managing all the hardware and application in computer. Here in figure you can see this is how operating system works. So here is a computer hardware which is controlled by this operating system, and then comes layer of system program. System programs are defined as a program that closely interact with hardware, and example of system programs are compiler, interpreter, linker, and loader. So basically the task of operating system is to manage computer hardware for application program and users. Now these application program, we can give example of application program as a Microsoft Word, Excel, and PowerPoint. Now when you, for example, open your Word file using file menu and open option, actually your file is stored in somewhere in hard disk, in sector and cylinder, right? So from there Word cannot open file. What it does is it requests Windows operating system to open that file for it, and once that request is given to operating system locates that file from hard disk and send back to Microsoft Word. Similarly, when you double click on Microsoft Word icon, it starts. So for that, operating system loads Microsoft Word from secondary storage device to primary memory, and then you can see the whole interface of Microsoft Word. So in short, application program depends on the facility provided by operating system, and then comes users. users use this application program, which depends on either system program or operating system in order to efficiently use our hardware. So we can say an operating system is an essential component of computer system. The primary objective of an operating system is to make computer convenient to use and utilize system resource efficiently. An operating system is a large collection of software which manages resources of the computer system. Now, what do you mean by resource? There are mainly four resources we are using. First is a memory or primary memory, then processor, then storage or secondary storage, and input output device. In order to run any program, we require memory, processor, storage, and input output. So operating system manage all these resources for you. It keeps track of status of each resource and decide who will have a control over computer resource for how long and when. It does not only manage resource, but it also provides you the security features, like if you have on permission, then you can print your file onto printer, right? So it does not only manage resource, but it also decides who will use which resource. If two requests comes together for using shared resource, then it will consider which request should be executed first. So this is how operating system manage resources. Now let us try to define operating system. Now how to define operating system? So first definition is, it is an integrated set of specialized program used to manage overall resource and operation of the computer. Now you might understand that operating system is required to manage these resources. Four resources we have told: processor, memory, storage, and input output. So it is it manage overall resource and operation of computer. A software that act as an interface between the user and hardware of the computer system. The main objective of operating system is to provide layer between hardware and users, so that user need not to bother about hardware, how to use this hardware. It just use that with the help of operating system. Third definition is, a software that provides working environment to the user's application. We have seen any program need to use operating system in order to work efficiently and properly. Otherwise, it cannot work. So it is an environment to the user's application. Fourth definition might be a resource manager that manages the resource needed for all the applications in the background. So you are using processor, you are using secondary storage device, you are using primary memory, you are using input output devices, but you need not to worry how to use it. It is the responsibility of operating system. It is specialized software that controls and monitors the execution of all other application that resides in the computer. So these are the various definitions of operating system. Now let us try to understand why we need operating system. We have give some good reasons for using operating system. So these are the need of operating system. So here are few questions for you. You might want to know, while storing data on file, who is allocating memory to the file? Who is mapping logical path of file to the physical location of file on hard disk? When you save your file, you give some name and storage location, but ultimately it is stored somewhere on hard disk. So it is operating system responsibility to map this logical path, which is your some path on your hard drive, to get that file from physical location. So who is mapping logical path of file to the physical location of file on hard disk? Now, today's computer can open and manage multiple windows at a time. Who is managing all windows? Who protect user data to unauthorized access by another user? You know that you need to first log in into computer in order to start your computer if you have provide password protection, right? So who is protecting our data? And while print command is given, who is transferring the data from file to printer? Then, when any request is sent for the data from network, who transfers data within network? And who provides the mechanism to transfer data between two applications? And who manages CPU and makes sure that it is not sitting idle or busy forever? Our CPU should not be in not working condition, or it should not be in too busy conditions. So it is a responsibility of operating system to make sure that it should not sit idle or busy. Who schedules the process for the CPU execution, and who manages the memory and how it is allocated as and when it is demanded by the process? So answer to all these question is operating system. With the help of operating system, all these tasks are done by the user. So these are the needs for operating system. Now, what are the objective of operating system? We have discussed what is operating system, what are the layers of operating system, what is need for operating system, but what are the objectives of operating system? Let us try to understand. There are three main objectives of operating system. The first is convenience or user friendliness. Second is efficiency. That means more work in less time. And third is ability to evolve. Nowadays, we are using Windows 10 operating system, but it was started with Windows 1 in 1985. So gradually from Windows 1 to Windows 10 operating system keep upgrading without creating any problem to previous version of operating system. So this is called ability to evolve. Now let us learn one by one. The first objective of operating system is convenience. The main goal of operating system is to provide convenience to its user. That means operating system hides the complex mechanism of hardware handling from the user and provide user-friendly GUI to its user. Now, what do you mean by this? Now, for example, if you buy some pen drive from market, which may be of any brand, and when you attach that pen drive to your computer or system, it should detect that pen drive and allow you to copy and paste file without worrying how it will be stored into pen drive. So this is called convenience or user friendliness. Similarly, if you brought a mouse to attach with your system, it just you plug and play and it will work fine. So this is how it provides convenience to its user. So first objective is convenience. Now let us take second objective, which is efficiency. Operating system makes the computer system convenient to its user in an efficient manner. Now, what is efficient manner? That we discuss. So it effectively manages all the resources such as printer, hard disk, RAM, and CPU. Your CPU is a very processing power. But what will happen if your RAM is of small size? Obviously, you will get less performance, right? So it is the responsibility of operating system to optimize these resources. Operating system makes arrangement that each running application can get resource as and when it is demanded. OS uses scheduling algorithm. So each application utilizes computer system resource at its optimum level. And finally, it keeps track of who is using which resource. If you have a permission, then and then only you can use resource. And last is ability to evolve. We know that there are various versions of Windows, from Windows 1 to Windows 10. So operating system should be constructed in a such a way as to permit the effective development, testing, and introduction of new system functions without interfering with existing services. What does it mean? Why Windows is so popular? Because of these three features. First, it is user friendly. Second, it is make optimum utilization of resource. And third, its ability to evolve. You can easily upgrade from Windows 7 to Windows 8 and Windows 8 to Windows 10 without any problem. So these three features should be provided by operating system. So we can consider the reason or objective of operating system is three. First, user friendliness or convenience. Second, optimum use of resources. And third, it should be easily provide new functionality without creating problem for previous version. Now let us try to understand how operating system evolves. Today's operating system is called modern operating system. So from beginning, how it becomes so user friendly and with silent features. So initially there were serial processing operating system, then comes batch processing operating system, then multi-programming was introduced, and then time sharing operating system comes into picture, and there is a real time operating system, parallel system, and finally distributed system. So the journey of operating system starts since 1950, and today what we see is the modern operating system. So how all these operating system works, let us try to understand one by one. In serial processing, it simply means only one task at a time can be performed. Multiple tasks are not allowed. So serial mode of operation is obviously not very efficient, and it results in low utilization of resources. CPU can process multiple processes, but we are only using it for single, so it is not efficient. So serial processing is not good. So then comes batch processing. Batch processing means perform similar job together. Instead of performing task one by one, what we can do is we can group together similar task and then execute it on operating system. So it results in more utilization of CPU and all other resources. Now, for example, we take some other example which is other than shown on screen. Earlier, computers had a limited processing power and limited memory and resources. For example, if we want to prepare payslip of company's employee, then what we can do is all tasks, all preparing payslip is a common thing. So we can give batch of 100 employees payslip processing program to operating system, and when it finish, we can start another batch. So this is how batch processing concept works. Now, if you have any question, we will take it at the end of the session, right? So I request you not to raise hand till now. Then, as we discussed, batching similar jobs brought utilization of system resources quite a bit, but there will still problem. If batch stops somewhere in between start to finish, then it creates some problem, and you cannot use resources until that batch finished. So there are some problems with batch processing. Then the concept of multi-programming evolved. Now you can see in this figure that multiple programs, program 1, 2, 3 and so on, are running in primary memory. So single user cannot always keep CPU or input output devices busy at all times. So multi-programming offers more efficient approach to increase system performance. Now, because there are multiple programs are running simultaneously, we can make best use of our CPU and other resources. So it offers more efficient approach to increase system performance. Now, in order to increase the resource utilization, system supporting multi-programming approach allow more than one job. You can see in the screen that many programs are running. Nowadays, you can start Word, Excel, PowerPoint. Earlier, it was not possible. If it is not multi-programming, you cannot use multiple programs. In DOS, you have to use any one program at a time. But in multi-programming, you can use multiple programs. So then multi-programming concept was evolved, and more number of program competing for system resources, better will be the resource utilization. That means we can use same resource for all users, right? The idea is implemented, which is shown in figure, and we can say main memory contains more than one program. Now, suppose if we are using serial processing, then here we have two programs, program one and program two. So once program one is finished, we can start program two. And here you can see idle. Idle means, for example, program P1 requires data entry from user. So it goes for data entry from keyboard. For this much time, CPU doesn't do anything. So it becomes idle. And once data is entered by user, P1 can restart or start from where it was stopped, and so on. And once P1 program is finished, then program 2 can be started. But in case of multi-programming, what will happen that P1 program is initially chosen by the CPU, and when it goes for reading data from keyboard, it can start executing P2. And once P1 finish reading data, it again takes P1 for execution, and so on. So this is how multiple program can be executed by operating system, which supports multi-programming. So this is we have already discussed. Then concept of time sharing or multi-user operating system evolves. We can say it is a specialized form of multi-programmed operating system, which operates in an interactive mode with a quick response time. You might heard name of Linux or Unix operating system. Linux or Unix operating system is called time sharing or multi-user system. Here user type request to computer through keyboard, or sometimes it is also known as a terminal. The computer process it and response is displayed on user's terminal. A time sharing system allows many users to simultaneously share the computer resources, which means there is a one CPU which actually operating system is installed and other are just using that computer using keyboard and input, other input devices, right? So any user can print a file which is available on this printer, and they can store or access file from this computer. And since each action or command in time sharing system takes very small fraction of time, only little CPU time is needed for each user. Now what happens, these operating system gives time to every user which is connected with it for a few milliseconds or microseconds. So these users feel that they are continuously using some computer. So as the CPU switches rapidly from one user to another user, that he has its, that each user is given impression that he has its own computer, while it is actually one computer that shares among many users. So these are the advantage of time sharing multi-user operating system. Now you might come across these three terms: multi-programming, multi-processing, and multitasking. Now what is difference between these three terms? They looks or sounds identical, but there is a difference between these three terms. Multiprogramming refers to situation in which a single CPU divides its time between more than one job. So multiprogramming means single CPU, multiple programs. In multiprocessing, multiple CPUs perform more than one job at a time. Remember, multiple CPUs and multiple jobs or programs is called multi-processing. And finally, multitasking. Multitasking is described any system that runs or appears to run more than one application program at a time. So this is the difference between multi-programming, multi-processing, and multitasking. Now finally, real-time system. Now remember the three objectives of operating system. The first objective was user friendliness. Second objective was efficient use of resource. And third objective was ability to evolve. But in real-time operating system, the main objective was response. Response means when input is given, how fast it can give output is called response. It is form of operating system which is used in environment where large number of event, mostly external to computer system, must be accepted and processed in short time or within certain deadlines. Example of such applications are flight control, real-time simulation, etc. For example, in our border or line of control, our military place radar system to track any unidentified plane which cross our borders, right? So if it happens, then it should immediately launch missile to collapse that airplane which unauthorizedly comes in our border. So here the quick response time is required, otherwise what will happen, it will escape. So real-time system are frequently used in military application. A primary objective of real-time system is to provide quick response time, and user convenience and resource utilization is secondary concern. The main objective is to provide quick response time based on some event. example is given that when any plane crosses our border unauthorized. So this is called real-time operating system. Then comes parallel system. You might heard dual core, quad core, octa core. So what does it mean? Dual core means two processor, quad core means four processor, and octa core means eight processor. So there is a trend of multiprocessor system. Such system have more than one processor in close communication and share the computer bus, clock, and sometimes memory and peripheral device. These system are referred to as tightly coupled system. Then the system is called a parallel system. So dual core, quad core, octa core are called parallel system. Now what is advantage? It increases the throughput, means the time required to execute particular task, and by increasing the number of processor, CPU get more work done in shorter period of time. And last is a distributed system. Now, instead of buying one large processing capability processor, what we can do is we can have multiple processor, which is a geographically distributed, and we can collectively use all this processor to perform tasks. So that is what is distributed system is. A distributed operating system is one that looks to its user like an ordinary centralized operating system, but it runs on multiple independent CPU. The key concept is transparency. In other words, the use of multiple processor should be invisible to user. Now, here is a figure that you can see the distributed application architecture. There may be multiple computers A, B, and C and so on are available on network, and it is distributed application that runs program on these multiple computers to execute in efficient manner. And there are distributed operating system services. Services may be network services, print services, file services, and so on. So this is how distributed operating system works. Normally, we have operating system on single computer, but here operating system runs on multiple computers without knowledge of users or in background. When you store your file, you don't know whether it is stored locally or in some other computer. But whenever you require that file, distributed operating system provide you that file. So this is the concept of distributed operating system. Now, what are the advantages of distributed operating system? First of all, price performance. So instead of buying a single system with more processing power, we can buy large system consisting of small processor, and it results in lower cost. Another is incremental growth. Suppose you require more performance, then what you can do is you can add few more computers in your environment and you can achieve more performance. Third is reliability. Suppose I have one super computer, but what and it has a huge storage capacity and processing power and everything. But what will happen if that computer crashes? So here we have huge computing power due to all these processor and memory with them. But we don't have these reliability issues, because even if one computer stops working, other can still work because of this distributed operating system. So third is reliability. Now let us conclude. In this lecture, we have learned about definition of generalized operating system, evolution of operating system, how modern operating system with all these concepts, multi-programming, time sharing, real time, distributed, etc., comes, and what are the needs of operating system. And we discuss three objectives of operating system. I hope you enjoy this session. Thank you and happy learning. Now, if you have any question, you can ask one by raising your hand. If you have question, you can still ask. So I hope you have no doubt in your mind. Thank you.